Welcome to the intersection of faith and the culture. This is Wallbuilders Live with David Barton and Rick Green. Thank you for joining us today. You can also visit online at wallbuilders.com and wallbuilderslive.com. David, we're going to take on a controversial subject today. I think most of the time we take on controversial subjects, but here's one that's obviously been in the news an awful lot, and we're going to talk about the Sandy Hook massacre of those children. A crazy guy goes in. And forget now, you know, it's been, what, a month? It's enough time that it's time for us to think rationally and talk rationally about this. A lot of people have just, you know, fired off, hey, just take away all the guns. That's going to solve the problem. Let's talk about what the real problem is, and let's talk about what some of the solutions are. First of all, you know, what are some of the crazy things you've heard in response to this?
Well, we pulled together some clips on this, and so let's just start right off the bat with the governor of New York. He's on a radio program, and this is what the governor of New York is saying. This is his solution, his call.
I understand the rights of gun owners. I understand the rights of hunters. As you know, I have a gun.
It's a shotgun, is that right?
Shotgun,
right.
Yep. So
hang on, Justin. That. Hold it right there for a second. All right. I got to throw this in, Rick. When people say, hey, I want to take your guns away, but I want you to know I have a gun myself. This is like the old deal is I'm not a racist. I know a black. I'm not anti-Semitic.
Right.
I know a Jew. I mean,
right.
When they start saying, hey, I'm a gun owner, too, that is absolutely that's a guarantee they're headed in exactly the wrong direction. I mean, that is that ad hominem kind of, I'm one too, so I'm regulating myself. That is, well, having said that, now you know what's coming. So, Justin, let's go back to playing the clip.
Shotgun, is that right?
Shotgun, right. Yep. So, I understand that.
Sure, it's not easy.
Right. The question is on the other side, at the availability of assault weapon type guns to people, or as we've seen, who have the potential to do tremendous damage. Our focus is assault weapons. What is an assault weapon? In this state, the assault weapon ban is more holes than Swiss cheese.
Although it's more restrictive than the federal ban, even the one that had been, I think, the one that expired.
Yes.
Yeah. It was a Pataki ban, so-called.
Yeah, and it wasn't a ban. You know,
it was a ban on certain types of semi-automatic rifles.
Yeah, well, it defined an assault weapon more by cosmetics than capacity.
So did the federal law.
Right. And then it grandfathers in anything pre-94, and you can't tell what's pre-94 because they don't have any dates or any serial numbers on the magazines.
Well, that was grandfathered in the magazines, not the rifles. But what's the alternative to grandfathering in magazines or rifles other than confiscation? And you got, you know, a lot of millions and millions of gun owners out there who don't want to have their weapons or their magazines confiscated, and they resist.
Yeah, well, you could say, well, confiscation could be an option, right?
Yeah.
Sale.
We've never done that before, right. I don't think.
Mandatory sale to the state could be an option.
That's a form of confiscation.
Right. Permitting could be.
Did he really just say what I think he just said?
Keep your gun, but.
Did he really just say what I think he just said?
He did. He said what you just thought. And I got to point out, he doesn't even know his own laws. He says that, you know, we grandfathered in all these assault weapons that were not. No. It was the magazines that were grandfathered. So he's not even aware of what his laws already do. He just wants to react and add more laws. I mean, he's not even clear. And this is part of the problem with these guys is it's cosmetic stuff. They think that you've got to pass the law to solve any problem. But confiscation is part of it. We can either confiscate your guns or we can require you to sell your guns to the police, which is another form of government confiscation. So he's going to come in with his set of gun control laws, of which you heard clearly that he has no trouble with those two forms of confiscation. So that is one reaction, one clip from one governor. Now, here's a reaction from the faith community. This is actually the pastor at the National Cathedral Church in Washington, D.C. This is an Episcopal church, and he's speaking on behalf of all Christians, at least he says he is, and this is what he says.
The Christian community, indeed, the entire American faith community, can no longer tolerate this persistent and escalating gun violence against our people. Enough is enough. For a variety of reasons, our political culture has been unwilling and unable to address the question of gun control. But now it is time that you and I, as followers of Jesus, help them to do that.
There you go. So followers of Jesus have got to force the political people to do gun control. And so that's a position of the faith. And there have been a number of faith leaders, Christian leaders, who have jumped out and said, absolutely, we have to do this. We have to take care of stopping guns. And it's going to be up to Christians to force political leaders to do that. So you've got political guys calling for it. You've got some Christian leaders calling for it. And then, as we saw, even in the midst of this, unrelated to the Sandy Hook, but another killing, a gun killing by a professional athlete. You remember Bob Costas got into this, and here's some of Bob Costas' comments that he made on that football game halftime.
Handguns do not enhance our safety. They exacerbate our flaws, tempt us to escalate arguments, and bait us into embracing confrontation rather than avoiding it. In the coming days, Javon Belcher's actions and their possible connection to football will be analyzed. Who knows? But here, wrote Jason Whitlock, is what I believe. If Javon Belcher didn't possess a gun, he and Cassandra Perkins would both be alive today.
So there you have another thing, that if there weren't guns, there wouldn't be violence. If it wasn't for guns, we would still have these people alive today. So this is part of the reaction that's going on out there. We've seen Dianne Feinstein already, from the senator from California, filing gun control legislation. A bunch in the House have done so as well. According to the House Minority Leader and the Senate Majority Leader, there's a bunch more legislation coming down the pike. So this is where we are as a result of Sandy Hook. It has become an impetus for political folks, for some Christian leaders, for even sportscasters to say, we got to get rid of guns. This is our problem.
Yeah, because of course, like you said, if the gun wasn't around, this football player would definitely not have used a knife or a club or his fist. I mean, that would never happen.
No, there are no suicides that happen in the United States except by handguns. We have no suicides on records except those with handguns. And so if we would ban handguns, there would be no suicides. And you realize how ridiculous and stupid that statement is.
But yeah, these guys, it's like facts and the real stats mean nothing. I mean, we've seen during this discussion now, all the stats coming out that there are far more murders done with clubs than with guns.
That's
in
right.
America. And yet these guys still make these ignorant statements. And man, I could spend all day going after Bob Costas. But we won't. We're going to take a break. We'll be back in a moment. Stay with us, folks. Reaction to all of these calls for gun control, because obviously it's the inanimate object's fault. This piece of metal is it. It's definitely not the heart of man. Back in a moment here on Wall Builders Live.
This is David Barton with another moment from America's history. Joseph Story is one of the most important names in American jurisprudence. Not only was he placed on the U.S. Supreme Court by President James Madison, but he also founded Harvard Law School and authored numerous legal works on the Constitution. While today's revisionists claim that the goal of the First Amendment was absolute religious pluralism, Justice Joseph Story vehemently disagreed. He declared, "The real object of the First Amendment was not to encourage, much less to advance, Mohammedanism or Judaism or infidelity by prostrating Christianity, but was to exclude all rivalry among Christian denominations." According to founder Joseph Story, Christianity, not pluralism, was the goal of the founding fathers in the First Amendment, for only a Christian nation is tolerant and thus is truly pluralistic.
For more information on God's hand in American history, contact Wall Builders at 1-800-8-REBUILD.
We're back here on Wall Builders Live. Thanks for staying with us. You can also visit us online at wallbuilders.com and wallbuilderslive.com. David, I said I wouldn't spend all day going after Costas, but I think we should set up the mentality here of those clips we just played in the first segment. Most of these gun control folks think that if you remove the gun from the situation, that there'll be no harm, that nobody's going to get hurt. I mean, Costas even said on O'Reilly, far more often bad things happen, including unintentional things, than things where the presence of a gun diminishes or averts danger. He goes on to talk about how, you know, people with guns have a dirty, hairy mentality, but that's not whatever happens. He really believes that far more often a gun creates a bad problem than a good problem, ignoring, of course, the fact that five times as often a gun's used to stop a crime as it is to commit a crime in America.
Well, this is because he probably does not have a gun himself and probably has never shot one in his life. And so what happens is people get real scared of things they're not used to, and they talk against them. Now, I'm speculating he may be a gun owner. Who knows? He may be a great shot. Who knows? But generally, that's the rhetoric you get from people who don't know them, who are scared of them. As some of those who are banning guns point out, is they look so mean. Those assault weapons look so mean. Well, you know what? Guess what? A little 22 pistol Derringer that doesn't look mean has just the same amount of lethal firepower as an AR-15 or an AR-10 or any other gun. So that's a ridiculous argument, but it comes from people who are not familiar with guns. And if you look at the profiles of what we've had with gun shooters, and by the way, mass murders, just by grins, Rick, can you think back to mass murders maybe since Columbine? What can you call? What do you remember of mass murders, if you were to name some incidents?
Oh, man, Paducah, Pearl, Jonesboro, everyone I can think of off the top of my head was at a quote-unquote, you know, gun-free zone, Aurora, Colorado, these places where we weren't supposed to have any guns. So the good guys weren't there with guns, but the bad guys sure were.
Well, what you have is 62 incidents. We've had 62 incidents since in the last 20 years. And so you do have Columbine. You got the stock exchange trader in Atlanta, Georgia, who killed 12 people. You got the gunman in Fort Worth, Texas, who killed six.
And that was at a church service, right?
You got the sniper shootings of 10 dead outside of D.C. You got a laid-off worker who shot and killed six of his former workers in Chicago, Birchwood, Wisconsin. You got a guy that killed six other, or actually got an argument and killed six and wounded two. Then opened fire at a church in Brookfield, Wisconsin, killing seven people. Truck driver killed five schoolgirls, seriously wounded six others in Pennsylvania. You know, we forget all these things that have gone on. There's 62 incidents we've had over the last 20 years or so, and they have not come from guns per se. And by the way, assault weapons were used in less than one-fourth of those crimes. They have come from overwhelmingly, like three out of four have been mentally ill people. So if you really want to solve the problem, don't go after guns, go after treatment for mentally ill people. And since 1965, we've eliminated more than 90% of the beds that we had medically for mentally ill people. We've said, no, you need to be mainstreamed. You need to be on the street. We don't want you to feel bad about yourself because you have mental illness, or we're putting you right back out there with everybody. That's a lot more cogent to talk about than the guns, because that's the problem.
It's true, David, and I think virtually every one of the school shootings, these kids that come in and use guns, were on some sort of psychotropic drug.
That's right.
There's things happening there that nobody wants to talk about, and there's no question that's at the heart of this.
Now, let's talk about Wayne LaPierre from NRA. I was really surprised at how bold he was in press conference, because people expected the NRA to come out very apologetic and very, well, we'll do what we can to help. And they went exactly the opposite direction. I want you to hear what Wayne LaPierre said in the press conference they held after the Sandy Hook massacre.
The only thing that stops a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. Would you rather have your 911 call bring a good guy with a gun from a mile away or from a minute away?
Now, you take what he's got right there, and you take what he's talking about the solution for a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. You take these 20 or so shootings we've had over the last, or excuse me, 62 shootings over the last 20 years. How many of them were ended by a good guy with a gun?
I would think most of them. I know several, even school shootings where principals went out to the parking lot and got their gun, came back in and stopped it.
So there are some. Now, most of them are not. As you mentioned, most of them are in gun-free zones. But you remember the New Life shooting in Colorado where the off-duty police officer had her gun and she shot the guy down as he was taking more people out.
Yeah.
I've always kidded that, you know, you never see a shooting at a gun store. You see a shooting at a school. You have an Amish school. You have a public school. You have a shooting at a church. You never have a shooting at a military base, and you never have a shooting at a police station or a gun store. And then we had the shooting at Fort Hood. Turned out to be it was at a base. But then it turns out that we find out military guys are not allowed to carry their guns on base. So it's another gun-free zone.
Yeah.
So you're having all these instances of gun-free zones, and if they quit being gun-free zones, as New Life Church was in Colorado Springs, then suddenly the shooter doesn't take down all the people he intended, and all those extra mags that he had in his jacket that he was going to shoot, he didn't get a chance to shoot because a good guy with a gun took down a bad guy with a gun. And that's what these guys do not see and do not look at. They're just flat scared of guns. And the solution to that is exactly what the Founding Fathers said, and that is you start teaching kids to use guns when they're very young, because gun accidents are caused by non-familiarity with guns. Once you're familiar with them, you don't have accidents with them. I have searched, and in the founding era, I think I've only ever found two gun accidents, and everybody was hauling guns back then. You took your guns to church. You're required by state law in some states to take your guns to church. We didn't have accidents because everyone was familiar with how to use them. It's not being familiar that makes it dangerous. And so
From a young age.
I mean, you know, we talked before. I had my guys on guns when they were 4 years old. And, man, when they picked up guns, there was no playing cops and robbers, because you didn't point even a plastic gun at anything that wasn't supposed to be shot. I mean, you didn't wave that gun around in the house, water pistol or anything else. We treated every gun as if it was a real gun, and they learned from very early age gun safety, where to point it, where not to point it. You didn't have a swinging gun through the room. It was always kept at the floor or at the ceiling. You know, all the stuff that's there. But we did that from very early age. By the time they were 6 years old, they owned their own guns, and they were shooting their own guns. And of course, there was still supervision over it to make sure that you didn't have the dumb stuff that kids can sometimes do. But, man, by the time they were eight, they could teach gun safety classes because they'd been through all of this. And so it is a mentality difference that we've got to deal with. And the problem is not guns, and the solution is not going to be taking guns away. As a matter of fact, you know, Costa's talking about how the guns only create problems. Here's another clip from just recently. It's a news story in Georgia. And listen to what happened with this news story.
Donnie Herman was on the phone with his wife as an intruder was breaking into their home. Walton County Sheriff's deputies say the mother works from the home on Henderson Ridge Drive. Her nine-year-old twins didn't have school. Around noon, a strange man arrived at the door. Deputies say he began continuously ringing the bell. When no one responded, he grabbed a crowbar from his truck. He pried his way in. That's when the mother grabbed her kids, her gun, and hid in a crawl space.
The perpetrator opens that door. Of course, at that time, he's staring at her, her two children, and a 38 revolver.
Sheriff Joe Chapman says the woman began firing all six rounds, hitting the suspect in the face and neck five times.
She starts yelling at him, "Stay down or I'm going to shoot you again." And that's when she gets her two children out of the crawl space, and they run downstairs and run out of the house to a neighbor next door.
They ran next door, and the man took off in his truck.
There you go. So there's the use of a gun, and I think that solved a problem, not created a problem.
And that happens quite often.
Yeah,
David,
you see, too, since Sandy Hook, there's a lot of schools that have started saying, we're going to let our teachers carry. And that's not getting carried on the news. We already have schools in Texas where that if you're going to be a teacher there, you got to carry, because they don't want those kids being sitting ducks, which is what they are in a gun-free zone. So the solution for Sandy Hook is somebody take the guy out really early before he shoots down 25, 30 people, instead of saying, oh my gosh, let's call the cops. Well, it's a 15-minute response time. Maybe they can be here by the time he reloads for the eighth time. That is not the solution.
No, and these people that think the solution is to take the guns away just ignore history. I mean, the two of the worst school massacres in history. Well, the worst one in American history was Bath Township, Michigan in 1927, and that was a former school board member, and he used bombs, not guns. There was one guy in Germany that used a flamethrower and killed 11 and injured 22. And then, of course, in China, you got all of these knife massacres.
Well, the same day Sandy Hook took place, you had a massacre in an elementary school in China, 22 students and a teacher, and it was not a gun. They've got perfect gun control over there. They do not allow guns for private citizens. So that solves the problem, except for 22 kids and one teacher, and it's because of a knife-wielding killer.
Yeah.
And by the way, if you go back and not just look at that, but go back to Cain and Abel. You know, what was it that Cain needed to kill Abel?
Well,
a rock. That's all you got to have. I mean, that's not it. Or you even go back to what happened even now more than a decade ago. But you take the Hutus and the Tutsis in Rwanda. And what you have is the Hutu murdered 1 million Tutsis in 3 months with machetes. They didn't even use guns. One million chopped down. It's a heart problem. See, and that's the problem with this whole debate, is they're looking at what's in your hand, and what they need to be looking at is what's in your heart. If what's in your heart is right, I can give a 15-year-old kid a bazooka, a 50-caliber machine gun. I can give him the worst, most mean-looking gun in the world and have no trouble at all because if his heart is right, he's not going to point that at somebody and not going to pull the trigger. It's not what's in your hand. It's what's in your heart. And that's what these guys totally are missing in this debate. They're trying to deal with the externals. They're literally trying to kill an orange tree by pulling all the oranges off every year when, as we're told in Luke 3:9, you got to lay the axe to the root. And the root of this problem is a heart problem. It is not a hand problem. It is not what you can purchase problem. It's what's in your heart. If you got your heart right, you're not going to do the wrong thing with what's in your hand.
And the way to get the heart right, you don't remove God and religion from the culture if you want to get the heart right. That's going to make it worse. I mean, that, you know, you remember Franklin's quote to Paine about religion. He said, if men are so wicked with religion, what would they be if without it? Well, we're finding out because we've worked so hard to get God out of our schools, worked so hard to remove religion from our culture that we're not. You know, you're going to always have some evil. There's just no doubt about it. And that's why you have to have the guns to protect yourself. But you're going to have more of that evil if you take away the religion.
Well, what we've done is since 1962-63, we've said no religion allowed in schools. And it is one of the ironic things that we expect kids to live by. Don't kill and don't steal and don't perjure yourself. But we refuse to teach them that because that's unconstitutional to teach them. So we expect Lanza and these other guys to live by standards that we refuse to teach them. And I go back to what Daniel Webster said, great speech that he gave in July 4th, 1851. He said, the cultivation of the religious sentiment, it represses licentiousness. It inspires respect for law and order, and it gives strength to the whole social fabric. If we want to repress licentiousness, if we want to inspire respect for law and order, if we want to give strength to the social fabric, then what we have to do is cultivate the religious sentiment. And as he pointed out, whatever makes men good Christians makes them good citizens. Now, I challenge you in any of these mass murders, find a good Christian that the police arrested for these mass murders. And that's a simple solution. If you do not deal with the heart, you will never deal with behavior that comes from bad heart. Jesus tells us very clearly in Mark 7 that all crime comes from the heart. If you cannot control the heart, you will never have enough gun control. Cuomo can never confiscate enough guns. And then when he confiscates guns, he's going to have to start confiscating baseball bats. He's going to have to start confiscating ice picks. He's going to have to confiscate cars because people run over others with cars. I mean, there's no end to this.
And rocks. Going to have to confiscate
that's
all the
right,
rocks, right?
That's right. We'll have to take all the rocks. We'll have to ban all the rocks. Why don't we just get government to require us all to no longer use cars? Because there's more killing with cars than there is with guns. And if they're really serious about saving lives, they'll just ban cars because that way then a drunk can't take a car and hurt somebody. And the solution is just take the car away from all people so that nobody can misuse it. You know, that's the logic that we're going after here with guns, and it doesn't work.
Dave, you were talking about at the beginning of the program that you played that quote from that pastor saying basically that Jesus would get rid of the guns and that as followers of Jesus, we should get rid of the guns. But we should say, what would Jesus do? I mean, did Jesus call for a ban on swords or whips or any of those things? No, he did the opposite. I mean, he actually took a whip and you fastened the whip himself and used it. And he told his guys, when you go out, make sure you got your sword. I mean, he did the opposite of what that pastor's saying.
Well, but see that you're assuming that the pastor actually read the Bible and that's not likely. And it's also very not likely that pastor's ever shot a gun in his life or, you know, he's just scared of too many things. And the way you get over that is by actually being aware of it. And so the right of self-defense is a biblical right. You go back to Exodus 22, you go through Nehemiah, you go through all these other passages. God gave you the right to defend yourself, and that's what the Second Amendment is about. It is not a sportsman's amendment. It is not for hunting and fishing and shooting. And that's why when Cuomo says, well, I own a shotgun myself, now you know he doesn't have a clue what the Second Amendment is about. When it becomes a shotgun amendment or a sportsman's amendment, then you don't have a clue what your inalienable rights are or what your constitutional rights. And so that's the same with that preacher. He has no clue. He has not studied the scripture on this. He doesn't know that that's an inalienable God-given right. But see, the solution to this thing is, all right, if we want to have a debate in Washington, let's have a debate over getting the Bible back in schools. That's what we need to. I'm going to read here a quote from Thomas Jefferson. Jefferson said, I have always said and always will say that the studious perusal of the sacred volume will make us better citizens, better fathers, and better husbands. Now, that's what we ought to be debating is, hey, why did we take the Bible out of schools? Let's get it back in. And by the way, there's a lot of ways we can already do that. National Council on Bible Curriculum in Public Schools. If you want to prevent a Sandy Hook kind of a thing, then go to your public school and say, hey, let's get the Bible in our classes. We now have a number of states that have passed laws that allow you to have all these Bible curriculums in there. There's also a good news club. Start some good news clubs at local public schools near you. I mean, these are all ways to deal with the heart, and that's the only way we're going to deal with this crime that they're trying to corral from the outside is we're going to have to deal with it from the inside.
That's right. And then also, if government wants to take action on guns, they should take action on getting more guns in the hands of teachers and getting those teachers properly trained. You know, the more people you have, I mean, it's physically impossible for us to have a trained police officer in every home and on every campus or in every classroom. But you can have citizens that are almost like deputies because they've been through the right training.
Well, you remember that's what we've done with our pilots. Our pilots are now armed. Nobody's going to rush that door anymore like they used to because pilots are armed, and you don't know which pilots are and aren't armed, but you know a bunch of them are, and that's a solution. The same with teachers, and there's a ton of teachers that are very skilled and confident with guns and gun safety, and would be perfect to have several teachers in every school in America that are armed and ready to defend those kids.
Thanks for listening today, folks. We're going to have some links today at our website, wallbuilderslive.com, with some articles and things for you to learn more on this. And be sure and tune in this Thursday for our Foundations of Freedom Thursday. We're going to be talking about the Second Amendment. You've been listening to Wall Builders Live with David Barton and Rick Green.